Hi guys, this is Varsha. Welcome to InspoLife.in, powered by Scabium Solutions. I know you must be eagerly waiting to know who today's guest is. She is dynamic, energetic, and very inspiring personality. Today we have with us the founder of the Entrepreneur Zone, Ms. Nandita Shetty. Hello, Ms. Nandita. How are you?
Hi, hello. Thanks for inviting me. Glad to be here.
It's our pleasure, ma'am. And thank you for being here today with us. I know you are very busy, but you have taken some time out of your busy schedule for us, and we are so happy for that. And I know you were a faculty initially in the business schools, but you have suddenly quit the job and also started your own company, the Entrepreneur Zone. So can you tell us what services does Entrepreneur Zone exactly provide?
Okay, so I will also tell you how the journey started, so
yes,
probably
ma'am,
you will understand it better.
We'll love to.
Yeah. So I was faculty and handling business management in B schools. And all through this journey of more than two decades, I saw students come in with, you know, very fantastic ideas. They're so bubbling with energy and they want to do something. And then they join the business management. And in the very first semester, they used to come up with and discuss with me, you know, some very innovative, wonderful ideas. They wanted to start up, they wanted to, you know, start their own ventures. But what happens in these 2 years is that by the time they end the program, they actually forget, and they forget what they, you know, all the enthusiasm they came in with and all the great ideas, because by the time they reach the fourth semester,
yes,
there is always a, you know, placement happening, and before we know, the, you know, the big multinational companies and so many other corporates, they come and pick up these guys. And when you ask them what happened, you came in with very good, very superb and innovative ideas, what happened? At that point they say, no, we'll come back to this. Right now, you know, we got a good job and we got to go. So they used to go away. And then I would get a nice box of sweet because they used to get a placement, and that would be my first one. Yeah. And then I would meet them after a year or so, maybe in some alumni meet or something, and say, what happened? You know, you had such good ideas, and what happened? And then they would say, right now we are settling in our job, and you know, I've got married or something like this, and I would get my second box of sweets. And then I said, fine, what happened to your idea? And they say, no, we'll come back to that. And again, I would meet them, and this time they would say, my third box of sweets, and I have a kid now. So yes, what happened to your idea? And they said, no, we'll work for a couple of years, and then, you know, we'll come back and start. But I realized that this was happening for over many, many years, and they never came back. So imagine the number of students who come up with such innovative ideas, and we lose them in the process of educating them and then giving them off to the corporates, which is okay. But the point I'm trying to make is that somehow we are not encouraging them to start on their own, and we are training them to get a job. So that was where I tried to understand why is this happening. And I realized that it's not easy to start up. You know, you need a lot of support, help. Everybody needs to understand. So that was my starting point, where, you know, I said, if somebody can give them these support services and help them and handhold them, then maybe, you know, we'll find these guys, you know, inspired to start up. That's how yes, started the Entrepreneur Zone. Yeah.
Okay, ma'am. Yes, so what services does exactly Entrepreneur Zone provide?
Yeah. So what we do is we have a startup launcher program where we take them into the program. We nurture them and make them understand the startup journey, the challenges, the problems, and a format for starting up. And we give them connects with industry. We try to, you know, make them share with them a lot of startup stories. So it's in a structured format that we take them through and help them right up to launch. Other than that, they need a lot of services, like they need company registration, they need trademarking, they need intellectual property registration.
Yes.
And they need somebody to help them with finances. They need someone to make a business plan. They need us to connect them to the investors. So all these are the services which are in and around the structured program that we give them. So these are the services we provide, mentorship and support services.
Okay, that's good. So from takeoff to landoff.
Yeah. We call it start to startup.
Oh, yeah, that's great. Well, you were actually working as faculty in business schools for almost 2 decades, and it's indeed a great job to continue with. But what has motivated you to quit the job and start a business on your own?
Yeah, so as my story started off, it was these young, inspiring souls which were coming and, you know, wanting to do, but they had no support. So seeing them year after year after year, I felt, what's the point in, you know, teaching them every day the same theory? It's fine, I've taught for many years, but I need to help them to, you know, reach their dreams. And that is where I thought, you know, if somebody can give them that support, they need that hand-holding, that support, which nobody, I mean, they have, you have a lot of programs and all, but they need it from the beginning, and very few actually handhold you from the beginning. That's what I've seen. So these young souls whom I'm seeing year after year, they are the ones who are inspiring me that, look, we have dreams, but there's no one to help us with our dreams. So that's what is inspiring me. And that's what made me leave my job. It wasn't an easy decision. It was quite tough to come out of a career you have built over so many years. It's like just crumpling off to the ground after building a, you know, big building. So it was like I just collapsed it and I started completely afresh. I was myself a startup when I started.
Yes. Okay. Well, ma'am, before starting any startup or before choosing any startup idea, so what do you think are the qualities or the features that one should take care of?
Okay. So for any startup or entrepreneur, there are a few steps which he has to follow. And those are important because if he doesn't go in a structured way, it's very difficult for this person to survive. Startups usually have a very high failure rate because they just want to start up without understanding what the market is and, you know, what's the process. So we always take them through a process. And what the entrepreneur needs to, what the aspiring entrepreneur needs to know is, whatever he is trying to do or produce, a good or a service, is there really a requirement for it? Is he solving a problem or not? So the starting point is that you need to identify what is the problem you are solving.
Okay.
Whether you are making a product or a service, is there a problem you are solving? If you are not solving any problem, your product will not survive, unless it is a very upmarket product which has some aesthetic sense. Leaving out that, most of the products are products which help solve some problem. So you need to go to the market and you need to do a survey to understand whether what you are thinking in your mind and what you're passionate about, that same thing is required by the market or not. So market survey, that's the first point.
Okay.
Then he needs to validate, yes, there are enough number of people who want this product. Then he needs to see whether to produce this product. You know, we say there should be technical feasibility, operational feasibility, and financial feasibility. So you can make a product, but if it is too expensive, nobody will buy. So can you make the product what people need and solve their problem at a price that they want to pay and at a time that they want the product? It should not be too early in the market, not too late.
Okay,
so this should be the right time. And this product should be wanted, it should solve a problem, and it should end up in giving you, financially it should be feasible and give you at least some profit over and above cost. Then only you can survive.
Okay.
Yeah. These are a few things which he has to keep in mind. And he has to make a good team, of course. Without team, he can't do anything.
Yes, that's right. Well, ma'am, if a person already has a startup idea and if at all, if he's not aware of anything like how to start, how to turn it into a business. So what steps should they take? I mean, can you explain us a stepwise manner, like how to turn it into a business?
Yeah, so we say that for any startup, the first thing is idea validation. You need to validate your idea, whether this idea is good to go or not. Okay. So idea validation. By validating the idea, you need to, as I just said, you need to go and survey people and see whether they need that product or service that you are planning to make a business out of. Is that something that people really need? Okay, and when I say need, it's not 2-3 people. The need should be a large need, because you cannot make a business out of a small market. You need a big market. any business has to have a relatively large market. So validate your idea. After validating the idea, and when people tell you, okay, this is the way we want the product, then you make a product market fit, we say. Product market fit. That means the product you make should fit the market. Okay, so idea validation, product market fit. After you find the product market fit, then you start making a prototype. Then you start making a prototype which suits the requirements of the people. And you make a minimum viable product which you put in the market again to test, because now you're giving it a price.
Yes.
So you put it into the market like a test drive, like how you go for a test drive on a car. You test drive with the product, you put it in the market, and then you see whether people are liking the product at the price that you are offering. If there is any thing which is not looking good, in the sense people are not happy with the product, then you bring it back and tweak it, you change it, and you know, you make those features in it which people want, and also float it at a price that they are willing to pay. So we call that as go to market strategy. So push it into the market with go to market strategy. So understanding the market, the industry in which you are operating, is of prime importance.
Yes, ma'am. We know many people tend to start startup, but after few failures, they usually give up because they cannot face any more struggles. And what kind of advice do you give to such people to stay strong even during failures in startup?
Right. So one thing is that if there was no failure, then nothing is possible without a failure.
Yes.
And failure is just a milestone to success. So as you keep crossing these failures, you are getting closer to success. So that is how you should take it. And there is no entrepreneur in the world who has not seen failures.
Yes.
So you end up seeing only success, whether it is Bill Gates, or it is Steve Jobs, or Zuckerberg, or any entrepreneur in India, even Ambani, anybody, whomever you see. If you ask them, they'll tell you what failures they have gone through to achieve this success. Whereas we see only success and we think, oh, success came to them, but we never celebrate failures. Actually, it is the failure only which made them achieve success. That is what is to be remembered. If it was not for the failure, it would not have taught them, no, this product cannot go in the market. It has to be changed. It has to be pivoted. It has to be altered. The price has to change. Every failure teaches them how to reach success.
Yes.
So I would say failure is that rock bottom foundation on which you build success and on which success stands. So if there is any entrepreneur who thinks that he will have no failures, then he is living in a fool's paradise. There will be failures, and he has to embrace them, and he has to pat himself and say, okay, I achieved one failure, now I'm closer to success. What was the second thing you asked me?
Yes, what personal or professional qualities should they possess to become successful?
Sure. So the first thing that any entrepreneur, I think, should have is what we say, fire in the belly.
Yes.
If he doesn't have the passion, if he doesn't have the fire in the belly, that's the first starting point. I think his basic eligibility is gone. So we call this as entrepreneurial mindset. So he has to first you know, build that mindset. Either he may have it or he has to build it, where he knows that life is going to be very tough. It's a battle. And success is going to come after failure. So that's the mindset. He knows it. And the faster it comes, the faster the failure comes, the better it is for me, because I can reach success faster. And no success can be achieved without the entrepreneur himself being very positive about it, a never say die attitude, and ready to be flexible enough to change as per the, what the environment requires him. He cannot say that I will go in this path. I am passionate about something, so I will make this product and put it in the market. I am passionate. The world may not be passionate, right?
Yes.
So, yeah. So if I come out with a product which I am passionate about, I have to match my passion or change it or tweak it or mold it according to what the market wants. So if I'm not ready to do that, that means my entrepreneurial mindset is not flexible. I have really not achieved, you know, that first, what would I say, that very first step to become an entrepreneur. So I need to have a very, very flexible mindset, a fire in the belly, ready to embrace failure, ready to persevere and work hard, ready to be focused on something, goals that I have in mind, and then just go out and fight it out. Without that, I think anybody can be. I mean, if it was that easy, then I think we would have had many more entrepreneurs than employees today. But it isn't. It isn't. So you need all these qualities, and of course, great skills to network. You have to be an extrovert, and you have to network. You have to push, you know, the pushy nature has to be there. Yeah.
Yes. Yes, ma'am. Many people start startup, and even their products or services, they give the best out of them. And due to some reasons, they can't find their customers or market. So what are the suggestions you would give to someone like that to increase their market or customer base?
So, there are two things. One is you are getting into a market which already has similar products, okay? So you're making a product which substitutes are already there in the market. Now, in such a case, you have to really find that what is it that they are producing, at what price they are producing, where can I enter and be different from them? So the first step for if a person is not finding any market is because he is not found a differentiator. So if he is entering into a market which already where the market is overcrowded with products that he is producing, he needs to clearly find a niche for himself. He needs to find that differentiator which makes him different from others. It could be very, very small difference, but that difference will sell. And that difference can be anything. That difference can be in starting from the design of the product, the features of the product, the color and design of the product, the packing of the product, the way it is sold, the way you interact with people and sell the product, the way you offer after sale services. So in any of these things, if you can find a differentiator, you can. Second, if you are entering into a market where your product is not known at all, there are no competitors, it's a new product. People are not knowing what this product is, something very new. Then in that case, you have to have a lot of patience, because you have to educate the people. You have to educate the people in what is this product. So there is a concept selling which has to happen. So the best example is Flipkart. When Flipkart came in India, it is now more than 12 years. People did not know what is e-commerce. They just never knew that, you know, you can buy online. Today, everybody goes online and buys one click here, one click. Today, it is common. But when they came here, some 12, 15 years back, actually, you did not know what is e-commerce. So people had to get used to this. E-commerce is a platform where you can go and buy online. The products will come to you. See, and even Flipkart also, See, Amazon came much later. Flipkart came first, okay? And they struggled to educate. Why did Amazon not come? They were waiting. They were waiting that somebody needs to educate. Why will we break our heads? After Flipkart came and they educated, then Amazon, it became easy for them because people knew how to go. And see, I'll give you one interesting example also. You all must be knowing this concept, COD. Have you heard of it? Cash on delivery.
Cash on delivery.
When you buy something, you get cash on delivery. I mean, you can pay to them cash on delivery. COD, it is called, COD.
Yeah.
This is only there in India, nowhere in the world.
So if
any foreign company also comes to India, they have to understand this market and educate the people first. That is over. But why did they do this cash on delivery? Everywhere else in the world, you have to pay your debit or credit card and then only the product comes. In India, the product comes and you can pay. One feature. Why did they give this? Because we don't believe and we don't trust people easily, and especially we do not know how e-commerce works. So they had to give this feature. And what am I trying to say? That every startup has to understand what his market is like. Features of the market. Then he has to, especially if it's a new product, he has to mold himself to the culture and to the people of the market.
Yes. How can one win the trust of investors?
Okay. So investors are people who understand businesses very well, and they have seen through so many startups, and they have also seen startups failing, startups succeeding. So they have their own metrics, you know, what makes success, what doesn't make success. So the first thing that investor sees is, and you'll be surprised, the first thing that investor sees really is the team. They are not so concerned about the product, because products can reach the market. But if the team is not good and dynamic, even a good product will not reach the market.
Okay.
But even a very simple, crazy product will also become a super success if you have a great team. So the first thing they see is the background of the team. That means the educational background, and the if they have work experience, the experience background. If they have worked in good companies where they know the processes and they have studied in premier institutions, investors are very happy first that the team is good.
Okay.
Then they see the idea and the product, and they see that, you know, this product is good enough and the team is good. So for idea, they see how good the team is and the idea, and then they see whether this will fit into the market in which they are trying to put. Is the country ready for the market, the timing, and then they see the network and connects of the startup and the team. So basically it's about how they can bring the product to the market and how dynamic they are. Then they see the idea, and then they also see whether how dynamic the idea is. These two things are the main.
Okay. It's really a new point I have heard from you, ma'am. Thank you very much. And yes, for a newly born startup, what do you think is correct? Be it cost of registration, or be it cost of advertising, or cost of labor, is it necessary to invest at the beginning itself? Or what do you think if someone can invest it after developing it to some extent?
So initially, every startup has to put in their own money. So we have a saying, the first money comes in from FFF, friends, family, fools. Why we say fools is, we are simply saying because we need to make those people believe in us, whether they are friends or they are families or they are outsiders who believe in our vision and our dream to make a business. If they believe in us and they say, no, this will hit. So that's the way the first money comes, your own money, your friends, your family, and people around you who believe in you. So first amount you have to put in, and after that, it depends. There are two choices here for a startup. One choice is, do you want to grow organically? That means slowly, by creating awareness, by putting the product, by reputation of the product, reputation of the startup or the company. You can grow the company slowly. It may take you a couple of years, but it's okay. The other way is that there are some companies who want to grow fast. So in the companies who want to grow fast, we call that want to growth hack. So when you want to growth hack, then you go for funding and you have to be dynamic enough to attract investors, get funding, and then pitch your plan to a couple of places and get a lot of money. And once you get this money, you can have a big team to market it. You can put a lot of branding and branding and all that. And so you need a lot of money for growing exponentially, not slowly. For yes. that, you have to put in a lot of money to spread the from your marketing team to spreading it to other states and to other countries maybe. So for all that, investment is required and you need investment. Also, one more point here is, see, there are some companies which can grow organically slowly. So they have a choice whether they want to grow slowly or they want to hack the market and grow fast.
Okay.
But there are some companies or startups, they from beginning itself, they cannot be a success if they don't have a scale, okay, a big operation. For example, yes. take the case of Uber or Ola. If they grow slowly, that business model does not work. So if you have only 100 cars in the city, 100 cabs or 200 cabs, it won't work.
Okay.
Because I need a cab in 10 minutes. So for getting a cab in 10 minutes, there should be so many cabs roaming around near my house,
yes.
right?
Yes, yes.
So unless I'm in a big model where I have the operations all around, I cannot offer my services.
Yes.
So for those models where you need a big scale, they definitely need to go big right from beginning, and they need to seek funding right from day one.
Okay. So it all depends upon the type of business we select.
Yeah, type yes. of business and type of model in which you want to grow. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So can you tell us, ma'am, what is the use and importance of collaborations in any kind of business?
Yeah, so I think every business, and more so with startups, they always look for partnerships. Nothing can happen. Today, if you see companies which grow fast, they grow by partnerships. Not just startups, even established companies like Google and so many others, they when they want to grow in a certain area, they actually like startups to come and work with them. And they do what we call as co-innovation. So big companies also, they ask startups to collaborate with them, because to do so much of research and innovation in a certain area, it's easier that if a startup is coming up in that area, you collaborate with the startup, and then this big company along with the startup works, and together they come out with something new. And either it's a partnership, or the big company may also acquire the startup. That is possible. Everything happens with partnerships. Whether you are an established company or whether you are a startup, I don't think any business can really work without great partnerships. And you look at the case of any big companies also, all the multinational companies which are existing today in IT and other sectors, when they want to really bring out new products, they actually look towards a lot of startups who are innovating in that field, are coming up with some new product or service. They try to support them with incubation. They bring the startup and then they go ahead with what is called as co-innovation.
Okay.
So most of the big companies today, they partner with startups to co-innovate, something, which is really good, because the startups also get the help from these companies, and these big companies also get new innovation into their company. Yes. Similarly, even startups also, amongst themselves, they look for a lot of partnerships. So it's like if I'm a food-based startup, okay, definitely I will look for a Swiggy.
Yes.
I will look for a Swiggy for home delivery. I will look for a Paytm or something for a payment gateway.
Yes.
I might look for some other company for packing the product. It could be possible. And I will look for another company for branding my product. So without partnerships, nothing works. So every company today, if you look at any company, from they basically do their core product, rest all they outsource it for partnerships. So you make partnerships for delivery, you make partnerships for branding, you make partnerships for packing, you make partnerships for co-selling the product in bundles.
Okay.
You make, the partnerships are there all around.
Okay. Yes, ma'am, as a woman or as an entrepreneur, what are the struggles you have faced so far?
Okay. So, I think like every entrepreneur, I've had my share of struggles. I think the first one was for me personally to come out of a mindset, of an academician and to change my mindset to become an entrepreneur. So that was a personal struggle. Also, another personal struggle was to, give up a career which I had built over so many years and a reputation of so many years to come to a stage of zero where I have to start again.
Yes.
So that was a struggle. And the third probably was to build a new reputation in a field I was not aware of, and to learn the field up, to mix with people, to network, and to build a reputation from being an academician to, becoming a startup person. So there was a struggle to build the reputation and to make partnerships and to sell your idea, to sell your concept, to sell your programs. It's all a struggle.
Okay. Yasmin, what kind of advice you'd like to give to college graduates who want to become entrepreneurs?
Go for it. This is the time. Nothing is impossible. There's going to be a huge unemployment gap in the future. So don't wait for companies to employ you. Employ yourself. And the next thing is, the world is getting increasingly automated. Everything is going to be done by robots. So think about it, jobs are going to be very few. If you are a little smart to and have analytical skills and creativity in you, and you have the fire in the belly, like I started off with, then go for it and sky's the limit. You just have to have the perseverance. It's not important whether you are so highly educated or not. It's more important that you believe in yourself, and it's more important that you are having the focus and the perseverance to continue believing in what you're doing and embrace failure and still go ahead.
Yes, thank you very much, ma'am. And one more question I would like to ask, what is the role of business plan in becoming successful?
So a business plan is that important blueprint. Like when you make a house, you have a blueprint for your house.
You
make every wall, every pillar that is going to come up. So business plan is that wall and that pillar and that room that you make to make this full house, which is called your business. You need all these bits. Every bit in the house is important, and you are building this blueprint in which you have your let's say your idea, your market, your customer base, your marketing strategy, your operational strategy, your financial strategy, everything put into the business plan. So without a business plan, you should not go ahead. You should always have a business plan. That's why there is so much of training given to make a business plan. So make a business plan, keep working on it, change it. It's okay, but keep making it and have it in the first place when you start a business.
Yes, thank you very much, ma'am. And with your permission, I'd like to go to into another round, rapid fire.
Okay.
Yes. Answer me in one word or one sentence, ma'am. Well, your first question, how has your professional life affected your family life?
A bit.
Who has been your greatest inspiration?
Okay. So, I think two inspirations very quickly, both women. One is Kiran Bedi, the police officer, celebrated police, famous police officer.
Yes.
She is for me an epitome of perseverance and surviving come what may. And in the business world, I think my inspiration has been Indra Nooyi, the CEO of PepsiCo.
Oh yeah.
She is an epitome of making your personal and professional life go hand in hand with success.
Yes. Yes. What's your all-time favorite book?
I'm always going with two because I have one in the fiction. That's a beautiful story of, it's called The Bridges of Madison County. Okay. It's about a lady and it's an awesome book. It's a book which I feel is so much about, you know, love and giving. So I just love that. It makes me feel good. And my book otherwise is a book by Ishiro and another author. I'm not getting his name. And that is The Courage to be Disliked.
Okay. Yes. If you were to write a book about yourself, how would you name it?
I think I would name it as The Courage to Fail.
Yes, that's great. How do you spend your free time?
Yeah, so my free time is with family, with music. I love plants, so I don't do gardening, but I like sitting amongst my plants and I play badminton. So that's how I spend my time.
That's cool. Yes. What is your strongest quality?
So I think my strongest quality, as I see it, is that I'm flexible enough to mold myself to my changing circumstances. So if you don't, I mean, if I hadn't, and I would have continued, but something in me told me there was a call in me and I was ready to undergo that change and, you know, build a new thing for myself, which is not easy after all the years you have put in. So the flexibility to change and then to continue and be focused on it.
Yes. What is your weakness?
My weakness is, I think like most women, I'm not too good at networking, because in the business world, you need a lot of networking. So we need to network more. So I'm okay, not too good at networking. And second is, I'm not too pushy as a person. So I think that pushiness also has to be there. So I see these as two, you know, bad qualities, which I should get rid of. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So what do you like the most, being the faculty or being an entrepreneur?
I think both have added. I would say when I have loved being with students, I have loved teaching business, I have loved writing articles and writing books also on, I've written two full books. So I've enjoyed everything and it has taught me a lot of things. It has taught me, you know, how to be analytical and to understand and to analyze. So whatever I have done, I think I've enjoyed doing it. And even this world, I'm enjoying it.
Yes, that's good. Are you a night owl or an early bird?
I'm in the middle, I think. I don't wake up too late. I wake up pretty early, but not that very early, not the 4 a.m. person.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah, I'm not the 4 a.m., but neither am I the 10, 11 a.m. I'm okay in the middle,
part. Yes. If you become the prime minister, what's the first thing you would do?
So if I think I'm given the chance to become the prime minister, I would say the first thing I would like to do is make it easy for people to start a business. Though they have made it, you know, easy over the time, but it's still not easy. It's still a process and it's quite difficult. I understand, you know, we need to go through some regulation, but if you make it a little more easier, many more will want to start up and you'll have so many entrepreneurs in India, and having so many entrepreneurs would simply make the country's income zoom up. So
yes,
countries which have done that have seen it. So why can't we do that? I would love to make it easy for all people to start business. Starting business should become easy.
Yes, that's a very great step, ma'am, really. And it's really been a great time talking to you. And thank you very much for being here today with us. How do you feel about
the
interview?
Thank you. The pleasure was all mine. Thank you so much for infolife.com for having me here and sharing a bit of what my professional, personal life and my what I want to see happening. It's been a pleasure being on the platform and talking to you. Thank you so much for this.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you once again. And we wish you all the very best for your future projects also. Thank you once again.
Thank you. Thank you so much.